Welcome to week four of Bible Studies for Life, the summer of 2024. Excited about the passage today. We're in the book of Exodus, chapter 19. So I think we're going to really enjoy what we see in the passage this week. If you haven't already subscribed, be sure and subscribe. Hit the little button there. Comment, share with us where you're watching from. If you've got questions, put them in there. Hit the like button, please. That helps the algorithm. I don't know what that means, but it does. And share it with somebody else. Appreciate it if you'll do that. All right, we're going to dive into Exodus chapter 19. Oh, before we do, if you want to support what we're doing, go to give.exposedtochrist.com. Let's look at this. In the third year, from the very day the Israelites left the land of Egypt, they came to the Sinai wilderness. They traveled from Rephidim, came to the Sinai wilderness, and camped in the wilderness. Israel camped there in front of the mountain. Okay, so we're the third month since they left Egypt. All right, so let's say April, May, June, early July, middle of the summer. Okay, middle of the summer, and they're here at in the wilderness. All right, they're next to now a mountain. In front of the mountain, that would be Mount Sinai. They're in the Sinai wilderness. So let's kind of give you an idea of where we're going. All right, lots has happened. We're in Exodus 19, okay? Go back, the call of Moses happens in Exodus 2 and 3. He goes into Egypt to deliver. So we've had the Exodus of the people out of Egypt, the plagues and all of that. They've crossed over the Red Sea. Lots of stuff's happened. They've complained about food and stuff already. And now they're in Exodus 19. We're almost to the point where they're going to give the Ten Commandments, which is Exodus 20. Right, so they're here at this place. They come to Mount Sinai. We know a lot of stuff, Ten Commandments and other stuff happens there. This is an important time, right? This is the beginning of that time. And so Moses went up the mountain to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain. This is what you must say to the house of Jacob and explain to the Israelites. You have seen what I did to the Egyptians and how I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Okay, so Moses goes up the mountain. God talks to him and says, here's what you need to say to the house of Jacob. Here's what you've got to say. Okay, and we're talking hundreds of thousands of people. Okay, that's the most likely number. How many that is, we don't know, but hundreds of thousands of people are traveling. This is quite a caravan going across the desert. And now Moses goes up to talk to the Lord on the mountain to have that time alone. The Lord tells him, here's what you need to do, right? And he says, the first thing you need to tell him is, you've seen what I did to the Egyptians, right? This is the Red Sea, right? How I carried you on eagle's wings, brought you to myself. Well, this is a thing that God does all the time, bringing us to himself. We don't seek God out on our own unless God has already called us, called to us. Our seeking him is a response to his Spirit calling to us, bringing us. This has always been the case, and it is here too. He's brought them out. He's bringing them to himself, which is a great thing, right? He's not bringing them to the middle of the desert in the summer. He's bringing them to himself. And this is a, think about it, there's a reminder here for the Israelites. Remember what I have done. Remember how I brought you out, because there is this constant theme that gets revisited over and over and over again in Exodus, where the people are saying, let's just go back. And they forget what that slavery was like. They forget how terrible it was. They forget what it was like to not be where they were supposed to be. They have rose-colored glasses looking back, thinking, you know, it wasn't that bad. And they forget, and the Lord is reminding them, I brought you out of this, and I brought you to me. I brought you to myself. Now he says, now if you will carefully listen to me and keep my covenant, you will be my own possession out of all the peoples, although the whole earth is mine, and you will be my kingdom of priests and my holy nation. These are the words that you are to say to the Israelites. Okay, so here's what else he's to say, right? Carefully listen to me. Listen carefully to the Lord. Listen to what he has to say. Don't just dismiss it or don't listen casually. Listen carefully. There is the sense here of listening so that you may obey. And that is always true with the Lord. The Lord, it's always when he says, listen to me, he doesn't just mean listen to me. He means listen and obey. Follow me. Do what I say. You ever have that experience where somebody asks your advice and you give them advice and it's you have wisdom that they need and then they just go and completely ignore it and you're thinking, why in the world did you come listen to me to begin with, right? Well, this is the Lord. Listen to me. And don't just listen to me and then ask, okay, should I do what he says or not? It's listen to me with the idea that you're going to do what I say because what I say is best and right. Listen to me and keep my covenant. We talked about that last week, that covenant, right? Keep your side of the covenant. Keep that. This is obedience, right? He says, you will be my own possession out of all the peoples. He's chosen this nation. And look what he's chosen them to be, a kingdom of priests and my holy nation. They are chosen to bring salvation to the rest of the world. They're chosen to bless, to be a blessing to the rest of the world. That's why he blesses them so that they, same with Abraham, right? He blesses Israel so they may bless the world. He's chosen them for that. He says, listen, this is who you are. Remember who you are. Remember this covenant. Remember that you are my people, right? You are my people. This is the whole earth is mine, but I've chosen you. And so after Moses came back, he summoned the elders of the people and set before them all these words that the Lord had commanded him. And when all the people responded together, we will do all that the Lord has spoken. So Moses brought the people's words back to the Lord. All right, he takes it down and says, all right, how are you going to vote? What are you going to do? What's going to be your response to this? And they say, we will do everything the Lord has spoken. Now, this is great, right? A great spiritual high time for the nation when they commit, yes, Lord, we'll do everything that you said. Now, what we know is that in the next chapters, they just completely rebel. They have very good intentions here, but it's easy to say these things early, right? It's easy in the beginning, and you get the spiritual high to say all these things. And you know what I always tell people? It's not important that you vote. It's important that you do. The vote to say, hey, we love that, we'll do that, is good, but that's not most important. The most important is that you actually do it, that you do what you said you were going to do. To say, yes, Lord, I'll do it, and then not do it, or then to do the exact opposite, which is not just I'm not doing the right, is that I am doing the wrong. Well, no, we've got to follow through, right? And Moses takes those words back to the Lord. He tells the Lord, okay, here's what they said. Right? And this is the setup of the covenant, that God has extended this covenant. Now, we've seen it over and over and over. It's not the only place, but over and over, God continues to extend the Abrahamic covenant to the people. And now this, you are the people of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That's who you are, and I've called you, and I'm going to use you, and I'm going to work through you, and I'm going to bless everybody because of you. Through you, I'm going to bless everybody. And they're like, yes, Lord, we love that. We like it. We want to do it. Well, at least we ought to have a good beginning, shouldn't we? Have a good beginning. But now, what is this? You must say to them, you have seen what I've done, and you've got to keep my covenant. Listen and keep. All right? This is the really key part here. Listen and then keep. Know what you're supposed to do and then do it. That's what God calls us to. That's our struggle, isn't it? To listen and keep. We say yes, but then sometimes we wander. And what you see in the Old Testament, as you see in the New Testament with the church and the book of Acts and the letters of Paul, the life that Jesus leads with his disciples in the Gospels, you see this constant struggle for people who want to do right, but boy, we struggle, which is not an excuse to do wrong. But it is a notice that the Lord's going to call you back over and over again because he's always going to keep his covenant with us. Just at least start well. Start well. Commit to that. Lord, we will listen and we will do. Well, that's important. Lord, we'll listen and we will do. Hope that's helped. God bless you. Thank you for teaching. Appreciate all of you that do that every week. Be sure and subscribe, like, comment, share it with somebody else. All right? We'll see you next time.